Hi guys, so welcome back to the Crash Course on Environment and Ecology. This is part 3.8 where we'll talk about the IUCN and the red lists, and it'll be presented to you by me, Shreyaa Sharma. So that's me right here, and you can read more about me here, and in case you wish to follow me, you can do so using this link so that whenever I create a new course or add a lesson, you're notified for the same. So moving on, let us discuss about IUCN. So the full form of IUCN is the International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, and it is an international organization working in the field of nature conservation and the sustainable use of natural resources, right? Now it is involved in data gathering and analysis, research, field projects, advocacy, lobbying and education. So this is important. Now, it also has an observer and a consultative status at the United Nations. So this is important. Do remember this, because at times the questions do carry the statements about the organization. So remember that IUCN has the observer and the consultative status at the United Nations. This is important. Now, it was also involved in establishing the Worldwide Fund for Nature and the World Conservation Monitoring Center. This is important. IUCN was established in the year 1948 and it had previous different names. Now, it is headquartered in Switzerland, right? So, these are a few facts about IUCN that you need to know. Moving on, let us talk about the Red Data Book. Now, it is basically a book of information on the status of endangered plants and animals, right? Now, it has different lists for different kind of categories. So, basically, there's a list which is the pink list, and it contains the critically endangered species. Then there is a green list that comprises of the species which were formerly endangered but have now recovered to a point where they are no longer threatened, right? So, this is important. Then there is a blue list which comprises of the organisms which are rare and are found only in a limited area. Then there is a yellow list which comprises of the organisms which look rare during a particular period of time. So they are seasonal variations here basically being talked about. Then there is a red list, and it comprises of the threatened species of plants and animals, right? So these are the various kind of lists that are present. Now, let us talk in detail about the IUCN Red List. So, the IUCN Red List of Threatened Species is also known as the IUCN Red Data List, and it was founded in the 1964, and it is the world's most comprehensive inventory of the global conservation status of biological species. So, this is important. Now, the IUCN is the world's main authority on the conservation status of species. This is important. And a series of regional red lists are produced by countries or organizations which assess the risk of extinction to species within a political management unit. So, this is important. Now, major species assessors include the organizations like BirdLife International, then other things like Institute of Zoology based in London. Then there are other things as well, but most importantly, do remember that the IUCN is the main body associated with the red lists. Now, the red list has different categories for organisms. So, the species are classified by the IUCN red list into 9 groups set through criteria such as rate of decline, then the population size attributes, area of geographic distribution and other factors. So, the first and the most important here is the extinct. So, no known individuals are remaining. Like, if a species has no known surviving individuals, like everybody, like the last organism has also died, so then it is known as the extinct organism. Then extinct in the wild. So here what the case is that they are known only to survive in captivity or as naturalized populations outside its historic range. So maybe in certain zoological parks or somewhere the members are surviving, but in the natural habitat, in the nature, in the wild, no surviving member is there. Then there are critically endangered, so they have an extremely high risk of extinction in the wild. So they are the ones who need immediate protection, because otherwise they will lead to, if they are not protected, they will surely go extinct. Then there are endangered ones, so they have a high risk of extinction in the wild. The next category is vulnerable, so they have a high risk of endangerment in the wild. Next is near threatened, so they are likely to become endangered in the near future. So they are not endangered as of now, but if the habitat loss and other things continue to factor in, they will go endangered in the coming future. Now, least concern, they have the lowest concern, lowest risk, so they do not qualify for a more risk at category, and widespread and abundant data taxa are included in this category. So basically, a lot of individuals of this particular species are present, so it has no particular threat immediately, right? Next is the data deficient, so not enough data to make an assessment of its risk of extinction. So not enough data is available for a particular species that we can assess as to what its status can be. So we put it into the data deficient category. And last one is the not evaluated one. So what happens here is that they are not evaluated against the criteria. So no particular study has been done. So we do not know what the kind of status for this particular species will be or is like. Now, when discussing the IUCN Red List, the official term threatened is a grouping of three categories, that is the critically endangered, endangered and vulnerable. So all the species that fall into these main categories, that is the critically endangered, endangered and vulnerable categories, they are regarded to be threatened. So this is important, can be a question as to what is the threatened species, like which all species come in here. So this is important. So here you can see not evaluated, data deficient, so basically nothing is done with it. Extinct in the wild is a category. So extinct and extinct in the wild is a category. Then these are the threatened categories, that is critically endangered, endangered and vulnerable. Then near threatened and least concerned ones are actually, they are not facing an immediate risk of extinction, so they are here. Now, this is the red list for India. So, I've included the various lists for critically endangered, endangered and vulnerable species of birds and mammals and reptiles. So, just go through it. So, the critically endangered mammals, the important ones are the Himalayan brown bear, then pygmy hog is important, then the Namdampa flying squirrel is important, the Kashmir stag is important. So, these kind of animals which I mentioned here, they are important. So, just have a note, glance through once and try to learn it, if not remember it fully, then at least just glance through it so that in case a question comes, you are well aware of what is being asked. So the next thing here is endangered mammals. So basically red panda is there, dhole is there, then Himalayan white-bellied musk deer is there, then the hog deer is there, lion-tailed macaque is there. Very important questions do come in from this. So do read about something about these particular animals as to where they are found and what kind of distribution patterns they have. Then a very important endangered marine mammals, right? So the gangetic river dolphin, that is also known as Planitacea gangetica, is important. Then the vulnerable mammals are here, so have a look. So isme, like in this list, a very important thing that you need to be taking care of is the Indian bison, then the Indian one-horned rhino. So they are important species, like the one-horned rhino has been so much in news with the Kaziranga National Park as well. So such species which have been in the news are important. Then the vulnerable species include the dugong or the sea cow. So it is a, like it's a herbivore marine mammal. So that's important. Next is the near threatened mammal. So basically black buck is an important one here. So next we have critically endangered birds. So do go through the list. So some of them, like the Siberian crane here, is important. Next, let's talk about the critically endangered reptiles. So hawksbill turtle is very important here. Gharial is very important. So just read about them, where they are found, what's their habitat like, what do they eat. So certain things you need to know, just Google it up. You'll find articles on Wikipedia. So read more about them. Then the vulnerable reptiles. So olive ridley sea turtle is very important. So much in the news, like Odisha coast, it comes to lay its eggs and stuff. So certain measures are being taken up to, you know, just to ensure that the act is done properly and no problems are there. So it has been too much in the news. So have a tab for it. So this was it for this lesson. Do rate, review and recommend. And thanks for watching.